Socialism seems like it's at the fringe of American politics today, but the socialist presidential candidate Eugene Debs won almost a million votes, twice. Socialism, populism, communism, labor agitation, and even anarchy have all played major roles in shaping America. It wasn't until the 1920s that the political career of Eugene V. Debs was ultimately destroyed. What happened to Eugene Debs and American socialism?
By the turn of the 20th century, America had been transformed from a mostly rural, agricultural country to an urbanized and industrialized nation. Small businesses and local manufacturing gave way to corporations, national distribution networks, and massive systems of factory labor. In 1900, America produced $13 billion worth of industrial goods, more than any other country in the world. Continuous production lines and a new factory culture that placed the ordinary worker at the bottom of the heap facilitated this increase in productivity. The labor needed to power these industries came from millions of working-class Americans, most of them recent immigrants. From 1865 to 1890, 10 million British, German, and Scandinavian immigrants arrived. After 1890, immigrants poured in from Eastern and Southern Europe. 15 million Jews, Italians, Poles, Greeks, Lithuanians, and Russians. Though some were more skilled than others, they were all abused by the factory system. 12 million families in 1890 earned less than $12,000 annually. In urban slums, the poor were packed by the hundreds into inadequate tenements. They lacked sanitation, basic healthcare, or even access to food. In the countryside, capitalists built company towns around their factories to provide housing and education for their workers. But these company towns were just extensions of the factory system, where everything lay under the owner's control. As early as 1836, one visitor recounted this of the Lowell Mills in Massachusetts, the model for successful company towns.
The operatives work 13 hours a day in the summertime, and from daylight to dark in the winter. At 4:30 in the morning, the factory bell rings, and at 5, the girls must be in the mills. A clerk, placed as a watch, observes those who are a few minutes behind the time, and effectual means are taken to stimulate to punctuality. This is the morning commencement of the industrial discipline, should we rather say industrial tyranny, which is established in these associations of this moral and Christian community.
In these conditions, workers turned to unionism and socialism, which promised them better working conditions. They struck for better wages and more benefits, including the 8-hour day, although company owners frequently responded with force to break the strikes. It was at times like these that Eugene Debs became concerned with the workers of the world. Born in Indiana in 1855, Eugene Victor Debs dropped out of public school to work in the Vandalia Railroad car shops. He later became a railroad fireman and joined a local fraternal benefit organization. He was even elected to the Indiana General Assembly as a Democrat in 1884. But when the owners of the Burlington and Quincy Railroad brought in private agents, also known as Pinkertons, to break their workers' strike with force, he became convinced of the need to organize a union for the workers' protection.
He created the American Railroad Union, which would later catalyze the events of the Pullman Strike. In George Pullman's company town, resentment stirred due to wages being cut to less than a dollar a day during hard times, even as food and rent costs remained the same. In response, workers in Pullman engaged in a near-unanimous strike, and thousands joined the ARU. On June 26, 1894, Eugene Debs and the ARU, in order to support their new members, refused to run trains with the Pullman cars attached.
"Pullman stands before you a self-confessed robber! The paternalism of Pullman is the same as the self-interest of a slaveholder in his human cattles. You are striking to avert slavery and degradation."
3 days later, Debs proceeded to rally further support in nearby Blue Island, Illinois, resulting in a series of sympathy strikes throughout the nation. U.S. Attorney General Richard Olney obtained an injunction against all union leaders who supported this strike. Debs disregarded the fact that his actions were now illegal, and federal troops were called in. Unable to recruit the AFL and other labor unions and leaders to his cause, the Pullman Strike was put down and Debs was arrested.
From each according to his ability, to each according to his need.
After his release from prison in 1895, Debs proceeded to found the Social Democracy of America. The result emerging the American Railway Union and the Brotherhood of the Cooperative Commonwealth. Debs' first attempt at the presidency under this party in 1900 earned him 90,000 popular votes, which was only 0.6%. This group split into two factions, and Debs went with the larger faction to form the Social Democratic Party of the United States, which by 1901 had changed again into the Socialist Party of America. Under this party, Debs ran four more times in 1904, 1908, 1912, and 1920, winning 400,000 votes, 3% in 1904, 420,000 votes, 3% in 1908, 900,000 votes, 6% in 1912, and finally 914,000 votes, 3.5% in 1920.
All the while, Debs ran on the radical platform he had picked up while reading Marx in jail. For example, the Socialist Party platform in 1912 denounced capitalism and called for the collective ownership of railroads and telegraphs, reflecting the dissatisfaction of downtrodden workers. Socialists also pushed for shorter workdays, regulation of working conditions, and public works projects to relieve unemployment. On April 6, 1917, Congress officially declared war on Germany. The Socialist Party of America saw entry into World War I as an extension of the military-industrial complex and responded by declaring the war a crime against the people of the United States. 2 months later, Woodrow Wilson signed into law the Espionage Act, which declared anti-war and anti-draft protests, such as those that the Socialist Party had been holding, to be illegal. The government, and later the press, widely considered the socialists and their anti-war element to be treasonous. To make things worse, on September 5th, 1917, President Wilson personally requested that the Justice Department raid all 48 U.S. headquarters of the International Workers of the World, the socialist labor union that Debs had helped found. Ultimately, over 200 IWW leaders were convicted. On June 16th of 1918, Eugene Debs became another one of those imprisoned for their beliefs. In Canton, Ohio, he gave a speech denouncing U.S. involvement in World War I and was promptly arrested. After being found guilty in Debs v. United States, he famously said,
"While there is a lower class, I am in it. And while there is a criminal element, I am of it. And while there is a soul in prison, I am not free."
In Debs' absence, the Socialist Party faced its most difficult decision, whether or not to join Vladimir Lenin's international communist group, the Comintern, which sought to expand the Russian communist revolution globally. Those currently in control of the Socialist Party kicked out those in favor of the Comintern, who went on to create the Communist Labor Party and the Communist Party of America. only a third of the original Socialist Party remained, and with the International Workers of the World effectively destroyed by Wilson's raids, the party was at a new low point. It was to this woefully tiny remainder that Debs returned after being released from jail on Christmas Day 1921. Fragmentation had reduced the party into a number of much smaller and less powerful units, none of which were able to effect change by themselves. Although Eugene Debs has largely been forgotten, he was a true American hero. Personally led the grassroots socialist movement for many years, pushing its ideas into the mainstream of American politics. Many socialistic policies have gained currency since his death in 1926, including government support for the elderly and the sick, public works projects, and a graduated income tax. If anything, Debs was enough of a political leader to win nearly a million votes from jail, and enough of a visionary that his ideas still live on today.